Joining us now via Skype for pro-life analysis of this week's RNC convention and the Trump-Pence campaign is Marjorie Dannenfelser. She is president of the Susan B. Anthony List and author of the new book, Life is Winning. We're also joined by Dr. Chad Pecknold, a theology professor at the Catholic University of America, who frequently writes about the church and politics and the American culture. Thank you both for being here. Marjorie, former Planned Parenthood Director Abby Johnson's speech at the RNC convention is getting a lot of pro-life attention. What was your reaction to that moment?
Well, the thing I'm most excited about is it's getting national attention. Beyond the choir, it is reaching people that who perhaps have not heard this message before. That struck me definitely. It was profound. It talked about the how the child recoils from the implements that are inserted to kill the child. And also, I was excited about the fact that this is a very different time. Life, it really is winning in America. The last Republican convention, there was nothing like this level of support for life. And this Democratic convention just recently hardly mentioned the abortion issue at all. So it's a flip script from Democrats to Republicans. Mm. Republicans used to bury it, they don't anymore. Democrats used to highlight it, and now they're trying to bury it. That's the right direction.
That's a fascinating insight. Chad, as a Catholic theologian, did anything stand out to you at this convention, particularly when it comes to the sanctity of life?
Yeah, you know, I noticed on the first night there was some who criticized the convention for not stressing abortion enough, but that was quickly wiped out the second night. I think obvious that this is a party, this is a convention that is a human dignity convention, a convention that actually does believe that life is winning and that we should ensure that life wins. And I think that that's clearly on display. I think that is in great contrast to Democratic cities, which are tearing apart human life, which are burning down people's places of work, and which are tearing down children in the womb in their Planned Parenthood clinics. These are the contrasts that we're living with in America right now, and the convention is really putting a light on that.
Marjorie, there is no updated RNC platform for 2020, and the 2016 platform will stay in place. That platform had been called the most pro-life platform, but is it able to address pro-life concerns and challenges we have today in 2020?
Well, I think without question, I mean, the platform certainly has a purpose. It is the declaration of principles that a party stands for, important. And it was and is the most pro-life that has ever been. What is most important is how those principles work out operationally. This president and this vice president and his whole administration, and now governors and state legislators across the country, are operationally pro-life, not just spoken principle, but action. And that is what is needed to win the human rights movement of our time. And that is happening right now.
In September of 2016, then presidential nominee Donald Trump wrote a letter to the pro-life coalition, and he made four pro-life commitments. He promised, if elected, he would be committed to nominating pro-life justices to the Supreme Court, signing the Paying Capable Unborn Child Protection Act into law, defunding Planned Parenthood as long as they continue to perform abortions, and to make the Hyde Amendment permanent law. Marjorie, President Trump has nominated Justices Kavanaugh and Gorsuch, who both have the support of your group, but where are we with these other pro-life commitments?
Well, where we are is that there is a responsibility that this Congress has had to present legislation for this president to sign that it has not done. There are only certain things that can be done through executive order. Now, I'm in really close conversation with the president, the vice president, the chief of staff, and other people at the White House about, is there anything else that we can do? There are a lot of rather complicated things that are taking more time than we have now. But I really do believe that there's hope even beyond what we've done before when it comes to defunding Planned Parenthood and reallocating those resources. The other piece, the signing into law of the 20-week pain capable bill, could not surmount the filibuster. Two-thirds in the Senate is a very high bar. Now, the Democrats are promising to undo that, to have end the legislative filibuster so that they can do whatever they want if the Senate comes into Democratic hands. But that would be a flip problem that we would have. But this president has done every single thing possible, along with the help of his vice president, in fulfilling all of those promises, especially the judges.
Chad, what have you made of President Trump's last 4 years on the life issue, and what would you like to see moving forward?
Well, obviously, many of us in the pro-life movement are very pleased about rolling $60 million out of the Planned Parenthood's budget. That was a really good start. And of course, the appointment of pro-life judges is very, very welcome. But I share some of Marjorie's concerns about legislative gridlock. And moving forward, I'd love to see some of the ideas that have been proposed. The idea that I support and I would love to see the president pursue is the Lincoln proposal, which is to exercise the take care duty of Article 2 and to use executive power to include the unborn under the 14th Amendment to give them protection under law. And that would have binding effect within the executive branch. It would be contested, but it would and could be used to pressure states, to use federal law enforcement on abortion clinics, using DHS or some other authority. This is exactly what Lincoln did to overturn Dred Scott. I think it's the only bold proposal that I've heard that I think is the president's capable of. He's capable of making a bold Lincoln move here, and I hope he does so.
Marjorie, I know you said you were in close talks with the administration right now. Do you expect President Trump to renew those four pro-life commitments or release a letter with new pro-life promises?
Well, I think tomorrow night we'll all be watching. I'll be there at the White House watching his speech as well. And I think we've been promised some pretty awesome things surrounding that speech and from himself. So I'm really looking forward to that. I think there are some surprises, meaning nothing I don't know about the Lincoln proposal, but things that I think that will be galvanizing to the country and that will help provide a contrast between this ticket and the other, where we absolutely know what the Biden-Harris ticket is going to provide. I just wanted to comment on one thing, too, and that is that beautiful connection that you made, Professor, between what's going on in the country and now the interconnectedness of human rights and the meaning of human dignity everywhere is what binds this time and helps highlight what's going on that's beautiful and what's not. Also, thinking about this historically, where the human rights battles have been won and how they're all connected to this particular battle. And I believe that is the president that we have. That's how he sees it, along with Vice President Pence.
Thank you both for your excellent insight. Marjorie Dannenfelser and Dr. Chad Pecknold, thank you both. And Marjorie, stick around because we'll be talking to you about your new book.